Cool. So, right. Hey guys, sorry. I'm sorry for the delay, but I'm here today to kind of run you through the key finding or some of the findings that you would expect to see in certain pathologies in the respiratory exam. I know UCL does the structure of it really, really well, so I'm not too concerned about going through that. I'm more concerned about telling you, you know, this is what you should see in these conditions. So just to outline our objectives. So I'm going to first go over very briefly some surface anatomy of the thorax, because that's quite important for when you're examining the thorax, whether it be respiratory or cardio. And then I'm going to do the overlying structure of the exam throughout, but concentrate on specific findings that you should see. And then I'll discuss common patterns. Don't worry if you're not on resp. A lot of this will come back to later on when we discuss the pathology in different sessions. But for now, this is just a good guide of, you know, for those who are on resp. Or even if you're not and you see just things on the ward. So surface anatomy of the thorax, you should all remember from first year and second year. The two main things I have highlighted are the jugular notch and the angle of Louis. And does anyone want to very quickly tell me why these are the two most important landmarks on the chest? I give you about 15 seconds to give me to kind of tell me why. If not, I'll move on. So, okay. Important because these are your two biggest anatomical landmarks for the thorax. Your guide is you find the jugular notch, leads down to the angle of Louis. The angle of Louis is your landmark for the second costal cartilage of the ribs, of the second ribs. And just below that is the second interspace. So from there, you can kind of figure out where everything else is by counting the number of interspaces. And then you can, I'll just go back very quickly. You can then dive yourself to the midclavicular line in the fifth interspace. That's typically where your apex beat is. Same for the anterior axillary line, right? So these are your two most important. And there's surface and landmarks for the plane of Ludwig, which is more radiological rather than to do with the examination. But these are the things that you'll find. So through the plane of Ludwig is the aortic arch, ligament arteriosum, pulmonary trunk, the carina, cardiac plexus, and then where the azygos enters the SVC. Kind of those are the important ones to remember if you're asked about the anatomy. Yeah, they do ask. They do like asking a lot about the carina and the aortic arch, in particular. So, on inspection at the end of the bed with a patient who you suspect has a respiratory illness from the history, you're going to look at them overall. So make a big deal of looking at from the end of the bed. Look at the patient. Are they well at rest? Are they out of breath? Are they really, really out of breath? Do they look distressed because they're out of breath, right? Are they using their axillary muscles to breathe? You can see them using the sternocleidomastoids, right? And pulling up their chest, bracing on the bed. Look around for medications. Are there inhalers? Are there steroids? Nebulizers? Make a mental note of it and be sure to jot that down later. Yeah, that's a good point. Are they on O2? So, and what mode of delivery and what percentage or what, how many liters are they receiving? So look at what they're taking. Is it nasal cannula? Is it Venturi mask? And then look at the wall where it's plugged into and just make a note, right? And then look for a peak flow meter if they're asthmatic, packets of cigarettes, e-cigarettes, nicotine gum to see if they're being treated for smoking cessation, right? Another thing you can look at is body habitus. So there are two textbook body habituses that you can see in respiratory patients. You have your pink puffers, right? And you have your blue bloaters. These are two extremes of COPD. So pink puffers are usually emphysema predominant. So the disease is predominantly emphysema, whereas blue bloaters are chronic bronchitis predominant. Don't worry if you don't understand what a lot of this means. Again, we'll come back to it when we talk about the pathology later on in the term. But the main things are, when someone asks you what a pink puffer is, it's someone who is very thin, very ectomorphic, right? They're breathless, they're barrel chested, their chest has taken on the shape of a barrel. So it's increased in the anterior posterior diameter and narrowed in their transverse diameter, right? They're lean forward, they're pursed lips, because in emphysema, you have a high closing pressure. You have an early closing pressure. So the airways collapse very easily on expiration. So they purse their lips to try and create a positive pressure within the airways to keep them open so they can get all the air out of their lungs. They're usually flushed and pink and on O2, right? There's no cough, very little sputum production. Whereas blue bloaters, they're usually very endomorphic. They're big body habitus. They're cyanosed. They're blue in the face and lips. They're coughing up huge amounts of sputum. And there's usually signs of right heart strain and CO2 retention. Okay? Just another note. I was just thinking of something. That's a very good image to reference as well. I'll move on for the moment. Okay. Then we go to the hands. So predominantly what you're looking for in the hands with a smoker are tar staining, okay, and clubbing. Clubbing is very, very classic, just described in the time of Hippocrates, right? It's increased soft tissue deposition within the nail bed and loss of the nail, the angle of the nail bed. And there are five stages to this. So stage one, it's not visible, but there is increased nail bed fluctuance. For those of you who are on Mod B and particularly doing surgery at the moment, when you're asked to inspect a lump and you say it's fluctuant, remember, fluctuant runs in perpendicular planes, okay? There's stage two, mild loss. So there's loss of Lovibond's angle. You can kind of see the angle of my nail there and on the photo there. There's complete loss of that, right? And this is where we see the obliteration of Schramroff's window in the bottom two pictures. So you ask your patient to do this, right? And anyone who has a normal, you might not be able to see it in the camera, but you should see Schramroff's window, which is a little triangle where the two nail beds meet. Three, increased curvature of the nail bed. So the nail curves over the finger, kind of like you can see in the bottom right picture. Four, gross, obvious clubbing, or sometimes called drumsticking. And the top photo is very good for this. They literally look like drumsticks. And then five is hypertrophic pulmonary osteoarthropathy, increase tissue deposition and osteoarthritis, particularly in the wrists, and is very, very painful. You can see it on X-ray. Causes of clubbing, very important. By the end of the year, consultants will expect you to be able to recite this to them. So, important ones. Pulmonary causes. Anyone want to suggest some pulmonary causes very quickly? Since this is, and then I'll rush through the other few. Cystic fibrosis, very good. Yeah. So, suppurative infections of the lungs, cystic fibrosis being one of them. Anyone know any other suppurative infections of the lung? Suppurative meaning pus producing. No? Okay. So, Hannah, you've got it right on the head. So, CF is one of them. Then there's cardiac causes, abdominal causes, congenital and idiopathic. In terms of your pulmonary causes, which is one we're concerned about at the moment, bronchial carcinoma, as I said, suppurative infections. So, empyema, where you have pus in the pleural space. Okay. You have lung abscesses, where you have pus in the lung parenchyma. Cystic fibrosis, because they tend to get chronic infections, and bronchiectasis, again, because they tend to get chronic infections as well. Then there's idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis and asbestosis. So those are the ones you need to remember for respiratory. Cardiac, shorter list, congenital cyanotic heart disease, infective endocarditis, and atrial myxomas. atrial myxoma is a very rare type of tumor that develops in the atrium. Anyone want to put in the chat the auscultation findings of atrial myxoma out of curiosity? Abdominal, liver cirrhosis, inflammatory bowel disease, celiac disease, right? And then you have your congenital and idiopathic. Some people just, you can ask them, oh, have you had this all your life? And they say, yeah, and actually my father had fingers that kind of look like this. So it may just be congenital. Next, you're looking at, so you've gone and inspected the hands. So then ask them to lay the hands on the bed, look for a tremor at rest. Ask them to hold their hands up in the air like this and look for a tremor. If they're on beta, if they're on beta agonists like salbutamol, they'll have a fine kind of just tremor, you know, that you can see. And another is asterixis. So you, as seen in the little animation there, ask them to hold their hands up like this. You press back on it, and then when you release, it's almost like they just flap on the way down. Carbon dioxide retention is the most common cause of it, as well as it's seen in hepatic failure, okay? It's usually indistinguishable between the two, but if you think someone has COPD, test it out, see if they have this, okay? Other signs of CO2 retention, they'd be warm, peripherally warm, very vasodilated. They'd have a bounding pulse at the brachial. So when they ask about the character of the pulse, bounding is usually what you hear with COPD. And they'll have headaches. Also check in the eyes because you might see some papilledema there. Next, this is where I jump up on my high horse a little bit. Next, you should always check the BP. So when you do, you inspect the hands, you've done the pulses, check the BP next. There's sphygmomanometers all over the ward. They even have old mechanical ones, which you'll be used to examine, and you will be examined on the Minoskis. So grab them, check them out. Of course, not in exams because you won't have time, but say to the examiner after you've checked the pulses, next, I would like to do the BP. They'll probably tell you to move on, okay? Pulsus paradoxus is seen in severe asthma. I had a patient yesterday who had a very severe acute exacerbation of asthma. I tried to elicit it, but he didn't have it, unfortunately. But this is a drop in systolic BP greater than 10 millimeters of mercury on inspiration. I've enclosed a nice little video of it from Stanford Medical School that explains what it is and how you look for it. It's just for interest if anyone wants to look out for it. Next, onto the face. Common things of the face, cyanosis. This is the blue tinge to the skin, and it's seen when there is greater than 5 grams per deciliter of deoxyhemoglobin. This correlates to about an SpO2 of less than 85%, okay? Two types, you have your central cyanosis, you have your peripheral cyanosis. Central cyanosis, tongue, lips, those are the kind of areas that are gonna go blue. COPD, severe asthma, so like life-threatening asthma is when you start to see that and you should be worried. Pulmonary fibrosis, those are kind of your common respiratory causes. Peripheral cyanosis, not so much. Respiratory, usually seen in the fingers, usually a vascular origin, cold weather, Raynaud's phenomenon, PVD, peripheral vascular disease, okay? Onto the face. So does anyone know what the top image shows? And what respiratory condition would you see the top image in, or would you suspect the top image in? Right, okay. First one, this patient obviously has a ptosis of the left eye, okay? So this is Horner syndrome. Now, there's more than just ptosis you see in Horner syndrome, right? It's ptosis, meiosis, anhidrosis, which means lack of sweat, and enophthalmosis, which is sinking in of the eye. Exophthalmosis is bulging out of the eye. So enophthalmosis, you can see in this picture, the The left eye looks more sunken in than the right in comparison to the right. Okay. Respiratory conditions it's associated with, Pankos tumor. This is a tumor of the apex, posterior apex of the lung, right? And the reason why you get a Horner syndrome is because it compresses against the sympathetic chain in the thorax, causing the Horner syndrome. So Horner's is usually is associated with damage to the sympathetic nervous supply, right, on that side. Other causes, trauma, thoracic aortic aneurysm, complications of chest drain insertion or pleurodectomy. Okay, so you can have some in the past when they used to have, when they used to do pleurodectomy, sometimes they may be a bit too aggressive, they may have taken it, but this is less common nowadays. The bottom image is this patient is very plethoric. So as you see red, round, swollen face, you can see also the precordium is a little bit red and dilated veins. You can see a bit on the trunk. Anyone want to suggest what could be causing the plethora? Is there something's obviously blocking, something's obviously blocking blood return. So what could stop blood from returning from the face to the chest? All right, if you don't know, I'll move on. It's SVC obstruction. So the superior vena cava is obstructed. This is where you can elicit what's called Pemberton sign. You can ask the patient to just raise their arms above their head, increasing venous return from the arms to the superior vena cava. If there's obstruction to the superior vena cava, their face is going to get more and more red and plethoric. It's very unpleasant. So, you know, you really kind of don't want to be putting patients through that. Bronchial carcinoma the right bronchus lies near the superior vena cava. So if it impinges on the SVC, you get SVC obstruction, okay? Palpation next. So you move from the face down to the neck. Predominantly what you're doing is you're palpating. So four things you want to look for: tracheal deviation, tricho-sternal distance, you want to look at the JVP, and you want to feel for the lymph nodes, okay? Tracheal deviation, normally our trachea is central in the neck, right? And you've probably been shown how to feel for it, but there are four things that cause it to deviate, okay? So if the trachea is deviated away from the lesion, there's a large effusion there, okay? Or a tension pneumothorax. Those are the two that cause deviation of the trachea away from the lesion. Towards the lesion, so the trachea is being pulled towards the side where the problem is, collapse of the lung, right? Or pulmonary fibrosis, where the lung gets so fibrotic and just stiff and tight, it kind of pulls everything towards that side. Next, cricosternal distance. I don't know if any of you have tried this or seen this on patients yet. This is the distance between the cricoid cartilage in the neck. So you feel you have your thyroid cartilage, and then just below it, you have your cricoid cartilage. And it's the distance between this and the superior border of the jugular notch, okay? Normally about three fingers in height, or 5 centimeters is the more standard measurement. Most people just use their fingers as measurement. Mine are a little bit bigger, so I have to kind of estimate a bit. When a patient breathes in, normally their cricoid cartilage will be pulled downwards into the thorax as the thorax expands. And, this is called the tracheal tug, right? There's increased cricosternal distance in hyperinflation of the lung and reduced tug. So you see these in conditions like COPD and asthma, right? Anyone have any questions so far? If not, I'll just move on. JVP is next. Ask the patient to, if you have the patient at a 45 degree angle, ask them to turn their head and look left. And then you look for, I won't go through the waveform. I'll leave that for the cardio exam. It's a bit too much. And then the difference between a carotid and venous, the JVP pulse wave. But the main thing is, if it's raised, respiratory causes are pulmonary embolism, because it's causing blockage in the pulmonary trunk, backflow into the right side of the heart, and then upward into the venous systemic venous system, right? Tension pneumothorax, again, squashing everything, raising venous pressure. Cor pulmonale, there's right heart strain, right heart disease. Again, increases pressure within the right side of the heart, and it continues into the venous system. And fluid overload. So it's two of the patients very, has, you know, CCF, congestive cardiac failure. AVP is low, although these aren't respiratory conditions, they're just two common ones. Dehydration, so they aren't drinking enough, they're hypovolemic as well. Okay, so next, lymphadenopathy. Two places you should check, the neck, right? So the cervical chain, the submandibular, submental, lymph nodes, preauricular, posterior cervical chain, supraclavicular nodes, okay? And the axillary nodes. Check both of them. And the common causes of lymphadenopathy in respiratory disease are cancer, tuberculosis, and sarcoidosis. So if you feel lymph nodes, start to suspect these things. But there could be other reasons why there. It could be reactive. They could have a viral infection, it could be reactive, but these are the things you should think about. Just a little side note, don't poke the neck. So I've seen some people just poke at the lymph nodes. Don't, it's kind of irritating for the patient. Roll them under your finger. Anyone want to give me, tell me what the sign is or what they see?
Can I just jump in really quickly?
Yeah.
Just remember, so in real life, you would do the axillary lymph nodes, but in an OSCE, you need to do the neck lymph nodes only, because you won't have time to do the axillary ones. You would say, I would like to check the axillary lymph nodes as the things you would go on to do.
Yes, that's a good point. So in real life, we check both cervical and axillary, but in the OSCE, just check and then say you would want to check the axillary. Thanks, Anish. Anyone recognize what's wrong with this patient or what they see in this picture? And what it is, what it's associated with, if you know?
Is it normal or is it abnormal to start with?
Yeah.
Any ideas? So, like, at the very minimum in an exam, you need to be able to tell if it's normal or abnormal. So it doesn't matter if you're wrong, just have a guess. So does the right side look normal? Does the left side look normal? You can just drop it in the chat. You don't have to speak.
Yeah, exactly. Just drop it in the chat. Don't worry about giving me what the sign is and thing. I'll explain that in a second. I just want, left is it normal? Thyroglossal cyst, if it moves in swallowing and tongue sticking out. Good, very good point. That's exactly what a thyroglossal cyst does, but a thyroglossal cyst is usually midline. This is in the left supraclavicular fossa. But you clearly understand what a thyroglossal cyst is. Good. This, so you guys are right. Left supraclavicular fossa, there is a very, very enlarged node. This is called a Virchow's node. And it is usually, yes, very good, yeah. It's associated with, Masako, do you know what's associated? Sorry if I'm calling you out on it. No, not really lung cancer. Usually associated with intra-abdominal cancers. I just threw this in because you might find it. You might find it on examination. So next we move on to the precordium, and we're going to palpate the precordium. Don't forget to the back. You don't need to palpate the back. It's more for percussion, but just at this point is kind of when you would start to think where, you know, how are you going to maneuver the patient to be able to see everything. First, I usually locate the apex beat, and then I check for a heave. Heaves will be talked about more in the cardio exam, so don't worry about that for now. Then chest expansion. So ask the patient to, you're basically asking the patient to breathe in and out, and you're seeing how much each side expands. And then tactile vocal frematus, right? So you ask, and I'll talk about that in a little bit, okay? Chest expansion. It can be reduced on both sides, or it can be reduced on one side. Causes of unilateral reduced expansion, consolidation, so pneumonias, right? Effusions, pleural effusions, collapsed lung, and pneumothorax, okay? Bilateral reduction, there's only really two causes. Fibrotic lung disease, and the big one is COPD or asthma, hyperinflated chests. And you can notice there's like very little movement in the chest itself. Vocal or tactile frematus. So you place tactile frematus, you place the back of your hand, not the back of your hand, the side of your hand against the patient's thorax, and you keep going down at each level and you ask them to say something like 99 or blue balloons, and you feel vibrations through their chest. Vocal frematus is essentially the same thing, but instead of using your hand, you're using your stethoscope, right? It's increased, so you feel increased vibration or you hear a louder sound in consolidation, and you hear a decreased sound in effusion. So this makes sense because sound travels better through solid, right? Consolidated lungs are usually more solid than those without consolidation. And effusions are fluid. So if you try and speak underwater, it's going to be quieter than if you were to speak through something that's solid. The vibration travels a lot better. Okay. Percussion. Practice the technique. So I won't go through that now, but you can do it anywhere. In bed, when I'm lying in bed and I'm bored, I'll practice percussing down my chest. I'll percuss against the table, even in the lifts when I'm waiting at the Royal Free. I will just practice percussing on my chest. It's just good because the more you do it, the better you'll get at it. Remember, on the back, lung extends further down the chest than it does in the front. So always be sure to go a couple extra interspaces lower, and always compare like with like. So do the right second interspace, then the left second interspace, or vice versa, and then keep going right, left, right, left. Just don't get too disheartened if you can't tell if someone is quite big and they have a thick chest wall. Don't feel disheartened if you can't tell if it's resonant or dull. It's very difficult because of the thickness of the wall. Okay. There's three types of abnormal sounds that you have with percussion: increased resonance, so a higher pitch sound. Right. This is usually in pneumothorax because the lung is collapsed. There's increased air within the pleural space, so it's like whacking a barrel with full of air. Okay, hyperinflation, similar principle, more air within the thorax. Then you have dullness, usually consolidation, fibrosis, and collapse because it's more solid lung there. Okay, and then stony dullness. It seems like it should just be dull, but when you hear it, you'll never forget it, right? It's just very, very, nothing goes through, no sound goes through it. It's just whacking, the sound of you whacking your finger is the best way I can describe it. Finally, we're on to auscultation. Main things: vesicular or bronchial breathing, added sounds, and then don't forget vocal frematus and whispering pectoralloquy. Whispering pectoralloquy is, I'll come back to in a second. So vesicular is a normal breathing or bronchial breathing. Don't worry if you have no idea what that is. Best way I can describe it: take your stethoscope, place it up to your neck, up to your larynx, right? And then take a couple of breaths in. That's the best simulation of bronchial breathing you'll hear. And just for reference, the first time I actually properly heard bronchial breathing was Tuesday morning. Okay. So don't worry if you don't get it it'll come with, you'll be able to pick it up with time. Added sounds, main ones, stridor. You're not really going to hear this on auscultation. You'll probably hear this at the end of the bed, and you should be worrying because this is inspiratory wheeze, and it points to obstruction within the large airways. Okay, alarm bells should be going off when you hear that. Then you have wheeze on auscultation with the stethoscope. Usually expiratory. Okay, asthma has a polyphonic sound. There's multiple. It's like musical, whereas chronic bronchitis, COPD, it's more monophasic, okay? There's only just, it's like, just a single note. And then severe pulmonary edema, you can also get wheeze. Crackles, coarse and fine, I'll talk about it in a second. And then a pleural rub. This is in an effusion where at the cusp of the effusion, you hear this rubbing sound as if a balloon is being rubbed up against your stethoscope, okay? Crackles, I said there were fine and coarse crackles. Coarse, due to secretions in the large airway, sound is altered. Sound can be altered if you ask the patient to cough. So, an example in bronchiectic patients, if you ask them to cough, the coarse crackles will disappear. Fine crackles, these are popping. If you take your hair and rub it between your fingers, that's the kind of fine, crackly sound that you'll hear. Usually, it's more distal, so alveoli opening during inspiration after overcoming a greater surface tension. So, pulmonary edema. Consolidation, these increase the surface tension within the alveoli. And that's how you get the popping sound. Then you kind of divide them into which phase you get it. So early inspiration, usually indicative of the earlier airways, earlier generations of airways, the bronchi and bronchioles. So chronic bronchitis, bronchiectasis, this is the kind of, pointing to that. If you hear them later in inspiration, it's pointing more to the alveoli, right? So pulmonary edema, consolidation. Right. Just very quickly, I'll explain whispering pectoriloquy. It's just a variance of vocal premises. You just ask the patient, instead of to say 99, you ask them to whisper 99. And it's the same principle. It's increased over, you'll hear much louder over areas of consolidation or collapse. But you'll hear much, you won't hear anything at all over areas of effusion. Okay. It's not really that, people aren't expecting you to know that for the OSCEs. The main one that UCL likes to ask about an OSCEs, vocal fremitus. So, six common patterns that you should be able to pick up by the end of the year. Don't worry if you don't start to get them together now, but these are some common things that you want to know by the end of the year. So, consolidation. Definition, region of a normally compressible lung, so full of air, that is now filled with a liquid, usually an exudate. In terms of infection, because we usually see consolidation in pneumonias, but we also see it in ARDS, acute respiratory distress, when in that case it's a transudate. Main findings, trachea is central in the mediastinum. There's reduced expansion on the side of the consolidation, okay? So there's also dullness to percussion, bronchial breathing and crackles. And again, like I said, vocal fremitus, whispering pectoriloquy, the sound will be increased over the area of consolidation. Associated conditions, pulmonary edema and pneumonias. Pleural effusions, this is a relatively straightforward one. There's fluid in the pleural space. Excuse me. Findings, you have a shifted mediastinum depending on how big the effusion is. Unless it's very, very big, it doesn't tend to push mediastinum away. But majority of the ones that you see aren't going to be massive. There's reduced expansion on that side. There's stony dull percussion. There's reduced breath sounds because vibrations travel much poorer in liquid than they do in a solid. There's bronchial breathing and reduce breath sounds over the effusion, and at the cusp, at the meniscus of the effusion, you might hear a pleural rub, okay? Associated conditions, like we talked about in the chest x-ray, and we'll go over in further talks in lung pathology, transudates or exudative causes, mainly congestive heart failure, cirrhosis, nephrotic syndrome, cancer, paraneumonic effusions, TB. Just a note on the kind of transudate ones, respiratory registrar was talking to me about it once. And he said, you kind of expect it to be bilateral, but a lot of the time you do see it to be unilateral. So don't be thrown off if this patient has, you know, CCF or cirrhosis or nephrotic syndrome, and they only have a unilateral effusion. Don't worry about it for now. We'll go through more of these causes later.
Liver failure, heart failure, and nephrotic syndrome, which is the kidney failing.
But we'll talk about more those in more detail later on. So don't worry about them now. Just good to mention so that you start to kind of remember, you know, make associations. Next, pneumothorax, easy one. Air enters the pleural space, increases intrapleural pressure, squashes the lung down. Okay. Findings, depending on the size of the pneumothorax, the mediastinum might be shifted. It's particularly worrisome if the mediastinum is shifted because it means it's likely a tension pneumothorax. So they may be hemodynamically unstable, and this is a medical emergency. There's reduced expansion on that side because, you know, the lung is squashed down. The percussion is hyper-resonant, could be normal. Don't be thrown if it isn't, if everything else kind of points to a pneumothorax. And there's reduced breath sounds of that area because there's no lung being filled when the patient takes a breath in. Causes, primary, predominantly trauma. Secondary, I haven't filled anything in here yet because there's a long, long list, and we'll go through that in another day. Main thing I want you to know is pneumothorax, collapsed lung, mediastinum shifted in tension pneumothorax, reduced air sounds, hyper-resonant percussion, reduced breath sounds, okay? Chronic airflow limitation, COPD, asthma, predominantly more COPD. Narrow bronchial lumen, so these patients are, you'll see them, thing I didn't mention before, look at how they're breathing. You know, is inspiration equal to how long they take to breathe out, or are they taking longer to expel air? A lot of patients with chronic airflow obstruction will have a prolonged expiratory phase. Okay, I'll talk about the physiology about that another time, but you know, it's something to think about. Oh, is this patient, you know, taking deep breaths in and then they only last a second, and then they take like 3 seconds to breathe out. Findings, hyperinflated chest, big, maybe barrel chest, like I said, in pink puffers. Central mediastinum, nothing's really shifting it. There's reduced hepatic and cardiac dullness because everything, the diaphragm is usually flattened because the chest is expanded more, pushing the liver down, right? Vesicular breath sounds should be normal, but you would hear a wheeze in these patients and maybe some crackles, coarse crackles and early in inspiration. Associated conditions, two big ones, COPD, chronic asthma. It's a nice easy one. Lobar collapse, where portion of the lung collapses down. This is, like I said before, mediastinum will be pulled towards the lesion. It's one of the two causes of the mediastinum being pulled towards the lesion. There's reduced chest expansion on that side because the lung is squashed. It's not opening up. There's increased vocal fremitus because there's solid lung there. Dull percussion note, again, like I said, solid lung. Reduced breath sounds over the area because the air, it's not being aerated, and sometimes you might hear bronchial breathing. Associated conditions, carcinoma in the airway causing obstruction and then absorption atelectasis. Same thing, foreign body obstructing the bronchi and bronchioles, again causing absorption atelectasis. And finally, pulmonary fibrosis. So this is scarring of the lung with increased extracellular matrix deposition, causing lungs to become stiff and less compliant over time. Compliance being the ease at which the lung expands and contracts over time. Findings, mediastinum usually central, can be pulled towards to one side if it's severe enough. Bilateral reduced expansion, normal or dull percussion note, vesicular breathing, and very, very fine crackles. idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, pneumoconiosis, those are your kind of conditions you're thinking about in this patient. So important to take a good social history, find out their occupation. Anyone got any questions? Sorry, it's a bit rushed.
Does anyone know what atelectasis is? I know that that's kind of a word, like you might not know what it is.
No worries. Atelectasis is just a collapse. Is just collapse of a lung. It's just another way of talking about saying a collapsed lung. Anyone have questions?
Preena, are you ready?
I think so. I still don't know how to upload my slides.
Just click the share button.
The open share tray thing. Oh, yeah. Okay. And share screen, or should I upload?
Upload.
I'll stop presenting now.
Cool. Don't know how to do that. Oh, browse, upload from my computer. I'm learning new things every day. Okay. Is anything happening?
It will be uploading. So don't worry about remembering anything from these lectures. Like, this is just kind of like an overview. Like, everything will be repeated. Like, nothing is taught once is the aim. So we'll come back to it, and you'll come across some of these terms, and you can use these lectures as like a revision resource when you come back looking over these things. So don't worry about learning anything at this moment. How do you think about stuff is like the aim. Also, Preena has a nice, like, a few like multiple choice questions for you. So if you go to menti.com, and then wait, I'll post the code in the chat.
If you want to say it out loud, Anoush, I'll type it out.
I'll be typing it.
Okay, don't worry then.
So it's in the chat. Go to menti.com. Oh, wait, it's not in the chat yet because Anoush made a typo. And type in that code, and you'll be able to access this poll. Cool. Right.
Can someone link Alex the feedback?
I'll do that as well.
Okay, should I start or?
Yeah, just go.
Okay, so question one on Menti. Anoush, have you set it up?
Yeah.
Okay, it's just like if it's out of four, like one out of four, two out of four, how confident do you feel with the Abdo exam? That's question one. So just like one out of four is like, I really don't know what's going on, and four out of four is like, yeah, I'll do it for you right now if you want, kind of thing.
Let's pretend A is one and B is four.
Okay, fine. A is like not very confident and D is really confident.
Who got one C so far?
Okay, good.
Got one A.
Okay, cool. Catering to all abilities, I can do that.
Only two of you have voted so far. As in, we just kind of need to know like what level to pitch at. There's only two people who've signed into Menti, so try and fill it out if you can. Okay, you just go on to the next question. Yeah, try and join in for the next one at least.
Okay, so basically the reason why I've asked is because this is going to be slightly different to Mark's. I'm not really going to like teach you how to do the Abdo exam. I'm going to sort of teach it to you slightly differently. It's going to be a lot more interactive, so like more than two of you are going to need to like put yourself out there, but realistically there's only like 10 of you here, so like enjoy the small group vibe and just participate, because that's the way you're going to get the most out of it. And to be honest, I'm literally only the year above you, so like I'm not someone that you should be embarrassed in front of. Okay, so this is the like abdo exam process that everyone teaches you about. You do like hands, face, neck, chest, and abdomen, and then you like palpate, you percuss, you listen, and then you like stop and think, right, I found this, this, and this on examination. So like, here's what I think is happening, here are my main differentials, and maybe now I want to order these tests and do these investigations. And that is how ideally you should do it. But the problem that I found in fourth year is that this falls apart for two reasons. One, I can't remember half the signs. And two, I can't remember what half of them mean. So it's a bit pointless sometimes. But the way I did it was this way, which is I'd look at the hands and I'd find whatever signs I found. And often that's nothing. But I'd be like, okay, I found something. What could this mean? And then already have a list of differentials to go. And then look at your next thing and you kind of know what you're looking for from there. So this will make a little bit more sense. We'll do it in a case. We'll do it in two cases, actually. And I'll chuck in some content on the side. And hopefully it's a little bit less strenuous than what you've just had with Mark. So we'll start with case one. You're asked to see a patient, and this is what you see on their hands. So step one, what is this? Someone put it in the chat, you know what it is. If you don't, guess.
So always the first thing you should ask yourself, is this normal or abnormal? So is this normal or abnormal on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side?
Do people's hands normally look like this, essentially?
Because if you can answer that question, the answer
is good. So this is deeper trines, and which side can you see it more on, left or right?
You mean the right of the picture?
The right of the picture, the person's left hand. It would be his right hand.
It is
the right hand. So dupatrize is when you get some fibrosis. It can be because of a lot of reasons. And it often starts with your like ring finger, but it can extend to your little fingers, and it causes the ring finger to be abnormally flexed. And the patient, it's not painful, I don't think, but they have control over it. So if you ask this person to put their hands out flat, they wouldn't be able to. This is what their hands would look like. Okay, so step one, we've got that this is dupatrines. Then the next thing you should think is not like, okay, I've done the hands, I've looked for all of this, let's move on to like their face. It should be, what are your main differentials? What do you know causes dupatrines? So does anyone like put in any guesses or causes that you know for dupatrines contracture?
Like at this moment in time, you might not know. But like,
I don't know. Yeah,
try and get you to think about it. Like, this is how you want to approach it.
Yeah,
so
really good.
Have a go.
Some liver disease, absolutely. Any other guesses?
What is a generally safe answer for what causes this?
Oh, this is a good point. Out a disclaimer, even if you're not doing mod B, like a lot of non-mod B stuff comes into this, so like there's going to be some endo in here as well, so like you don't think that the answer is going to be an abdo exam answer. Like, you can guess anything, and common stuff is often right.
At the end, we'll go through a list of things that cause absolutely everything in the body. So if you have no idea in an OSCE, you can always
guess it.
Fall back on them.
Yeah. So the two differentials that I got for this were alcoholism or cirrhosis, so some liver disease, as Rajashree said, and some diabetes. So now I'm thinking, well, step three, what are the signs do I know of alcoholism or liver disease and diabetes that I could start looking for what can back up where this examination is leading me? So I want you to, in the chat, put signs that you know of alcoholism, cirrhosis, diabetes, that you could see in someone's hands and face. Any signs in people's hands?
Is the liver going to be working if they've got cirrhosis? Yes or no?
Yeah, that's a good one.
Mm-hmm.
Liver flap, yeah. Very good. Okay, so yellow eyes, yeah, signs of jaundice, yeah, very good. Spider nevi, yep. Niraj is doing very well here, on an absolute roll. Okay, so I'm going to show you some of the ones I came up with. So for the alcoholism and cirrhosis, there is a very long list, there's a slide a little later that will give you a fun way to remember them. But palmar erythema for the hands and leukonychia. So palmar erythema is where the thick parts of your palm are abnormally red, so like erythematous palms basically. And leukonychia is when you get white stuff. Leuko means like white cells, that kind of thing, and it's on your nails. And then for diabetes in the hands and face, the stuff you could look for is xanthelasma. So someone put in the comments what xanthelasma is. Okay, I'm going to tell you, xanthelasma is where you get like lipid deposition. Yeah, exactly. Cholesterol deposition around the eyes, and it looks like yellowy patches around your eyes. Acanthosis nigricans is basically when you get blackening of like creases, and that can be anywhere, but commonly it's in your armpits and on the back of the neck. It's I couldn't really find anything on the pathogenesis of it, but it basically is an indicator of insulin resistance. So you can see it in some types of diabetes. And if someone has diabetes, there's a very high chance that they might also have a high BMI. So that's a very common sign that you could find. Okay, so you continue to inspect him, and currently in your head you're thinking, maybe this person has diabetes, maybe they have liver disease. And this is what you see. So step one, let's start with the left-hand image. What does the image show? What are you seeing?
I hope you haven't already forgotten this.
Is Mark still in the group? Because he might cry if someone doesn't just say it. Yeah, this is clubbing. Well done. And on the right-hand side picture, what are we seeing? Yeah, this is gynecomastia. It could also very well be a high BMI. Sometimes it's quite hard to tell, but this is why I included it. So this person has got clubbing and a high BMI. Okay, step two, what do we know that causes the clubbing and the high BMI or gynecomastia? So I'm not going to ask you to list off the causes of clubbing, partly to save Mark's feelings, and also because I never learned all of them. But in terms of the gynecomastia in men, the reason they get it is because their balance of estrogen goes off. So they have more estrogen than they're meant to, and their breast tissue just grows. the diabetes doesn't cause the gynecomastia. It causes is a cause of it. Like it relates to the obesity is what I'm saying here. Poor diet as well. So now what we're going to do is we're going to do a poll. Anoush. So the next thing I want you to know is now you've like looked at his hands, you've like silently looked at his chest and abdomen and his face, and we've concluded he's got some clubbing, some Dupuytren's contracture, potentially some gynecomastia / obesity, we're not too sure, of liver disease and diabetes. Which one is now your top differential? Which one do you think is more likely? So Anoush is going to set up a poll. Pick A if you think it's more likely to be liver disease, and B if you think it's more likely to be diabetes.
No one is in the poll, apparently. So join it.
Oh, shall I resend the number for Menti?
Yeah.
It's this one, 37. I've just put
37, 11, 25, 8. Get used to doing online polls. All of your teaching is going to involve this eventually by the end of the year because everyone hates them.
So just to repeat, A for diabetes, B for liver disease. Which one do you think he's got?
Ooh, one has gone for A.
Okay, so someone thinks he's got diabetes more than he's got liver disease, okay.
Ooh, someone's gone for B.
Okay. How many other people are there to vote?
Two out of two have voted. No one else has entered this thing.
Okay, well, I'm glad that you guys went 50-50 because this is exactly what like your head should be doing. Like you should be weighing up what you're seeing and what could be. I, when I made this case, put liver disease at the front of it because plus the like Dupuytren's and the fact that this probably is like, this to me looks a bit more like gynecomastia than obesity. I would put liver disease at the top of this. But do you see how like if you have this approach as you do your examination, when you get to the end and the consultant says like, what investigation would you like to order, you won't just aimlessly list everything. You will like think, well, I need to rule out diabetes, so I want his blood sugar and I want to do his liver function test, and it will make you feel a lot better in yourself because you know what you're looking for. And also this is how you, like you should be doing it, because you won't have time to investigate every single differential. So this was a short case. I've got another one coming up, but whilst we're on the topic of signs of liver disease, the liver ones that are quite logical to remember, you basically can remember them all based on the function of the liver. So the liver produces bile, and if it stops working, resistance to bile flow is a lot, or you can't conjugate it, you get jaundice and you get itchy. If a cirrhotic doesn't flow through it really well, it backs up in your portal system and you get portal hypertension, and that leads to varices. So does anyone know, it doesn't have all three, any of the locations where you can get varices and liver disease?
I mean, do you know what varices are to start with?
Yeah. Yes or no for if you know what a varices is, otherwise I'll explain it. Don't make me start picking on people. I really hate picking
on people, don't be mean.
So shall I just explain? Varices is when you have blood vessels which are usually collapsed and they dilate because there isn't enough space essentially for blood that's waiting to go into the liver to go. Three main locations that happens is around your esophagus, you get esophageal varices. around your umbilicus. So you get, they call it caput magister, but like their umbilical veins, I think they are, look really dilated. And then you get it around your rectus, so they get rectal varices. I'd look up the anatomy of those. It's not a question that they could very, they could ask you for again. Going back to the liver signs, if alcohol is a cause of liver disease, you can get uterine contracture as well. You can get signs of like concomitant malabsorption, so things like glottitis. Does anyone know what vitamin deficiency you can get glottitis with? Guess.
Do you know what glossitis is? You may need to figure that out using some Greek or Latin.
So glossitis is when B12. And do you know what glossitis is? Can you just like, yeah, write it in the chat? It's okay if you don't. Yeah, close, exactly. So it's like inflammation of your tongue and it appears really large and red. And it's a symptom of B12 deficiency that commonly alcoholics get. So the other signs of liver disease are if your liver is responsible for making all of your coagulation factors and proteins, or well, not all of your proteins, but a lot of them. So if you can't carry that out as a function, you get coagulopathy, which is basically an imbalance of your coagulation factors. So these people tend to bruise really easily. So when you're looking at their arms, they might have bruises. The other protein that they'll lack if their liver doesn't work is albumin. And albumin is like the main protein in your blood and the main protein that sucks water in or like fluid into your plasma. So it's what they call your like main oncotic protein. Yeah, is that the right word? Oncotic. It generates the most pressure and pull for fluid to stay in your circulating volume. And if that doesn't happen, or if you don't have enough albumin to do that, your fluid just like seeps out into your like into your normal tissue, not your vascular, not your veins and arteries, but your tissue. So you end up with like fluid in your abdominal cavity, that's ascites. You end up with edema, so like fluid in your legs. We'll go over like one day, I'll do the whole fluids thing for you guys. So don't worry if you don't quite understand the like physiology behind all of that. And like I said, if you have low albumin, you get white spots on your nails, that's called leukonychia. And finally, your liver is responsible for the excretion, breakdown, and metabolism of some drugs and hormones. And the main one that like causes some liver signs is if you have not enough breakdown of estrogen, and you get things like gynecomastia, the spider nevi. That's when you have like literally like spider-looking blood vessels. Does anyone know how many is normal on someone's chest? What's a normal amount to have? Guess. Any number? Anoush, could you put a photo of Spider Levi in the chat for me? Well, hello? Can you still hear me, or is Anoush the problem?
Oh crap, just realized I was muted. Yeah, we can hear you completely fine.
Oh, okay, cool.
Sorry about that.
Okay, so I think the cutoff is about five. If you have more than five spider nevi, that's abnormal. And they're basically dilated arterioles, and it's due to raised estrogen. Okay, so moving away from the liver, we're going to do case number two. So you're clerking another patient, and your brilliant judgment basically decides that your patient is completely fine, but their sister has this on their face, and she allows you to examine her because she's not feeling very well. So step one, what is this? Does anyone want to guess? Yeah, that's one name for it. Yep. So this is angular stomatitis. Good, Patrick. Yeah, that's the name I've got it for it. But it is also sometimes called angular colitis. So at the angles of your lips, you get these red lesions. Okay, so you've identified someone's got angular stomatitis. Step two, what do you know causes angular stomatitis? What are your main differentials? Anemia, yeah, good shout. That's the really big one that everyone remembers. Now think slightly further out, what are reasons people could have anemia?
This is a very broad question that you still won't fully know the answer to by the end of your final year. So take a stab.
Because we certainly don't. No, I mean it.
Yeah, we know a few of them.
What's a really, if you're a female in this call, what's a really common cause for anemia? Okay, I'm just gonna show you guys. So this is all of the sort of main ones I could come up with. So UC means ulcerative colitis, Crohn's, celiac disease. Those three are basically my fancy way of saying malabsorption. So they're not absorbing enough iron, therefore they're anemic. It could just be iron deficiency anemia, which has its own list of causes, and it could also be a sign of immune deficiency. So now that these are all of the things that we're thinking for in our head, what other signs could you look for to support any of these differentials? So someone give me, you can put in the chat any sign of any of these five causes. Spooning of the nails, yeah. Anyone here have asthma? No?
Me.
You have asthma. Who's that? Anoush?
Yeah.
What do they tell you to do after you have an inhaler?
Pardon?
What do they tell you to do after you use a steroid inhaler?
Wash out my mouth. I'm not on steroids,
as we go.
Yeah,
she's very upset about it.
I'm just gonna now get the answer out of Anoush. Why did they tell you to wash your mouth out?
You can get steroids immunosuppress your mucosa in your mouth, so if you don't wash out your mouth after, you get like a fungal infection.
Yeah, what fungal infection?
Candida.
Well done, Anoush. Spot on.
Almost like I've done the exam.
Exactly. So, again, clubbing is a sign that you could have used here. If you haven't yet realised, a good stab at the answer is always clubbing. So for ulcerative colitis and Crohn's, you can get these two conditions called erythema nodosum and pyoderma gangrenosum. The two bits of sort of dermatology that you probably do need to know for fourth year, sadly. Erythema nodosum is lesions commonly on your shins, and pyoderma gangrenosum is like an ulcer that I guess grows really quickly. And that's literally all I learned about it and their associations to inflammatory bowel disease. Oral candida is a fungal infection, and it's a sign of immune suppression or local immune suppression. So often people who have asthma, if they don't wash out their mouth after a steroid inhaler, they get oral candida. But if you're immune suppressed, or have a deficiency, you can also get oral candida. Okay, so you examine her face and her mouth and her hands, and in your head currently you're thinking she's got some form of inflammatory bowel disease or celiac disease, iron deficiency anemia, that's what FDA stands for, or some kind of immune deficiency. And I picked these differentials partly because this is an abdo exam, like this is all four modules of year four as well. It's A, B, and C. Yeah. So like, don't just ever compartmentalize mod B and gastro. It can mean a whole bunch of things. So I gave it away. Step one, what is this? If you didn't read it on the slide, what's the left-hand image showing? I'm giving it away because I can't really help you with this one. Aphthous ulcers. This is an ulcer in the inside of your like mouth, basically. Okay, what's the right hand image showing? What part of the eye is it? Yeah, exactly. So your conjunctiva is like the like bit you're looking into because they've pulled the eye down for you, so the inside bit. And pallor basically means that it's not as red as it could be. So conjunctiva pallor is what this image is showing. Okay, let's do step two. Okay, so now, Anoush, can you go back to Menti, please?
I can.
I've said what is the order of your differentials now. Which one is your top differential and which one is your bottom one? But for the sake of, like, the fact that Menti is Menti, I just want you to pick which one is your top differential now. Is it IBD, which is A, celiac, which is B, iron deficiency anemia, which is 3, and immune deficiency, which is 4? Do you want me to read it back out, Anoush? Sure.
No one is in the poll.
Okay, that's fine. Okay, Patrick thinks this could be iron deficiency anemia. Do you want to comment as to why, Patrick? Or not? It's okay. You don't have to. So what did I put? I actually put iron deficiency anemia. Yeah, pale eyes. Yeah, exactly. So I actually put iron deficiency anemia second. And the only reason I did that because all of the signs that we've seen, so they're like angular stomatitis, the conjunctival pallor, they are like very indicative of iron deficiency anemia, yes. But the ulcers aren't really. Whereas the ulcers are more IBD, they're more Crohn's and ulcerative colitis. And if you have Crohn's and ulcerative colitis and you don't know about it, you could have anemia as like malabsorption. So that's the only reason I put IBD above it. And then I said, okay, so maybe it's iron deficiency anemia, celiac, and nothing's really like pulling me to immune deficiencies, that can stay at the bottom. Okay, so you examine her abdomen, and here is your like current list in your head. And this, you see these two scars. So firstly, does anyone know what the names of these scars are? They're surgical scars. You don't have to say which one's which, just like any name that you know for a surgical scar.
Or if you know what operation, because like realistically.
Yeah, my next question is going to be, what does it mean? Yeah. Or I guess another way to think about it is, which part of the abdomen is it? Right or left? Right iliac fossa. Yeah, okay. What what structure is commonly in your right iliac fossa? Ileostomy could be, yep. An ileostomy, you wouldn't just see a scar, but you'd actually see other things there. Appendix, yeah, okay. So these are sorry, I'm confused. Patrick, is your question, is an ileostomy on the left or is the appendix on the left? The ileostomy, an ileostomy could be anywhere, but it is typically, Anoush, help me here.
They are typically on the right-hand side.
Yeah, just an important note, the position is not a reliable enough indicator for any kind of stoma or anything like that, because it could technically be anywhere. It does suggest it, but it's not a absolute sign, and you can go off there at any point.
We can cover stomas in the next session if you want. Masako was right on my end here. So this is the left hand lesion scar is called a gridiron, and on the right hand side this is a Lans incision, and they're both indicative of a previous appendectomy, and they'd be an open appendectomy. So someone just put yes or no now. Has the order of your differentials changed? Do you think having a previous appendectomy makes any of your, you know, thoughts in your head any more or less likely? Has this helped you at all? It could be one or the other. It could be yes or no. So someone guess. Okay, I'm just going to... So that your differentials are probably still the same. Like, having an appendectomy doesn't very obviously or outwardly link to any of the four thoughts that we've got in our head, and it doesn't bring any new differentials into the picture. So we're going to leave it as it is. And I put this here, one, because learn your surgical scars. You know, if not for the sake of the exam, but because it will help you understand what the hell is going on in surgery. And it will make a surgeon like you, basically. And they'll be more willing to teach you if you know the basics. So I learned the surgical scars, and that was my, that was my icebreaker. Every time I went into surgery, it was like, you know, what scar will you be using for this operation? Or like, you know, what incision are you planning to open or laparoscopic? And if you know that someone's going to do a laparoscopic procedure, and I don't know if you still get it, but even if you don't get this, if you get a surgical skills course, even if you don't get the surgical skills course, if you know someone's going to do a laparoscopic procedure, say to them, can I scrub in at the end and help stitch? Because laparoscopic scars are like the dream to stitch. They're small, they're straight, and like you don't have to do many stitches. So if you hate it after the second one, totally fine, but it's a great way to practice and get involved. So that's my top tip for people in Mod B. Learn your surgical scars. Okay, so case two continued. So you percuss her, and you find that she's got tinkling bowel sounds, she's like super distended, and she's hyperresonant. So I'm not gonna ask you guys, because I feel like you might get so your differentials now would be like she very clearly has some form of inflammatory bowel disease, and she might have some toxic megacolon, she might be obstructive, she might just have an exacerbation of her bowel disease. And all of this, if you don't know what it is completely fine, but these are like some high yield stuff that I would say like is a good starting point for your Mod B conditions. But the point I really wanted to say was, like, now you've examined her and you know, like, of all of these investigations that you could do, there's a few that will really help you. So, like, if you look at her temperature, you'll know whether she's got an exacerbation. If you do her full blood count and look at her white cells, you'll know whether she's got an exacerbation. The abdo x-ray will tell you whether they're obstructed, whether she's got toxic mycosis. You can go from there. So I think that's the last slide. I didn't put like the end slide, but essentially I didn't want to just sort of sit here and teach you guys like this is the abdo exam, this is what you should look for, because quite frankly the Oxford handbook will do a far better job than I would. But learn the signs, don't worry if you don't remember them all, but more importantly learn why you see what you see, because then once you're slick with it, you won't be thinking, right, this is what I need to do next on the hands, let's move on. You'll be thinking, this is what I've seen on the hands, it means this, can I see anything else in the face that also means this, am I hearing what I think I should be hearing? So this is kind of what you want to aim for, and don't lose sight of the big picture, don't just aimlessly learn signs for the sake of learning them, and you will all be great doctors if you keep going this way, okay? That's my like preach moment over. Does anyone have any questions?
Yeah, while you're here, if you can fill out the feedback, that would be really useful.
Oh yeah, fill out the feedback. And if you hate the way I did this, also put that in the feedback. Otherwise, there's more to come.
Yeah. Also, like, feel free to drop specific feedback for each person. Like, just put them on different lines. It's all very useful. Also, your prize for surviving to the end is the cheat way of listing the causes of things. There are three groups of conditions that cause every single thing in the body. Well, there's two groups of conditions and there's one category of things. Does anyone want to guess? Because like, if you don't know the answer in an OSCE, you need to try and provide a pretty good guess. That is your aim, because it doesn't matter if you get it wrong, but as long as you provide a pretty non-specific guess, you'll get some marks. So there are three big categories that me and Ahmed always fall back on. Does anyone know what any of those are? So not specific conditions, but categories of conditions.
Infective.
Preena, you're a fifth year. I wasn't asking you. So yeah, one group of causes is always an infection. Infections can cause absolutely anything in the body. So if you cannot think of the cause of something, say infection, then there's two other groups. So one is something we do to patients, and the other is a group of diseases. Preena, you're not allowed to answer, and neither is Mark. I mean, Ahmed is also obviously not allowed to answer as well. So what do we give to patients if we're not doctors, but when we're doctors, what do we give to patients to help them get better?
I can really do with some right now.
Morbid. You don't need to know anything about medicine to get this question, so guess. What do we give patients to make them feel better? I am slightly concerned if you don't know the answer to this question, not gonna lie. Drugs, yes, absolutely. And drugs can cause every single thing in the body. So if someone's bleeding from their esophagus, it could be due to drugs. If someone's got headaches, that could be due to drugs. So in an OSCE, when they ask you a cause, you're like, oh yeah, so an infection could cause that, drugs could cause that, and then they might ask you what drugs will cause that, and then you'll cross that bridge when you get to it. But there is one other group of diseases that causes everything in the body. If any of you have watched House, you will know about this group of diseases, because he says it's never these diseases. Well, one of them in particular. Also, funnily enough, this came up in last year's year four paper.
Did it? I have no idea what we're talking about right now.
So the last group of conditions is like autoimmune diseases, or more specifically connective tissue diseases. So things like rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, sarcoid, those can also cause everything in the body. So if you're really out of options, one of those three, and it will buy you some time in an exam to try and come up with some legitimate answers.
The other
Ahmed, how many times have you used some of those in a clinical setting when you've forgotten things? Ahmed's still alive.
The other thing I would recommend is looking up the actual vitamin D or your surgical SIB. My response. So if someone asks me the cause of something and I don't know, the way I buy time is, or like the way I remind myself is I'm like, well, you can categorize the causes.